Hi everyone. I hope everything's working correctly. And apologies in advance, this is my first ever live stream, so I'm quite nervous. This will be a bit of a mix between two concepts. First, I was about to go to Troopers a couple of weeks ago to present my new toolkit. Obviously, because of COVID, that was cancelled. So no Troopers. And that left me with like a half finished slide deck. So I want to start this off with some slides and some theory. And then when my slides run out, because I obviously didn't have all my slides ready yet, then I'll just start to showing off things live. Want to show you a bit of the code and want to show you how to install and run the new toolkit. So let's see. It's my small presentation VM. So the thing we're discussing today is RoadTools, which is a toolkit for both red teams and blue teams. And it's built around Azure. So it's really to explore Azure and try to get all the information that you can from Azure. I assume most of you know who I am. I'm Dirk-Jan, live in the Netherlands, work for Fox IT, like to research stuff in my spare time, and like to write tools also. So let's skip over that. And what we're talking about today is Azure AD. Now, for the ones that don't know that yet, Azure AD is basically the identity platform for all of Microsoft's Azure things. So it's Office 365, the Azure Resource Manager, where you manage your virtual machines and all the other Azure things. And it's also an identity platform for any first party or third party applications. So if you want to add authentication to your application, you can use Azure AD to do that. And this talk or this toolkit, it's not about Azure infrastructure or virtual machines. It's really about this identity part where all the users are stored, and also mainly about Office 365 related groups and things. So this all started during my research, where I was really wondering how you can best explore Azure AD. Because in Active Directory, a lot of research has already been done in how to explore it. And most information is stored in LDAP, so you can query that using some tools. But in Azure AD, you can't really do that. Some people have focused on dumping the global address list from Office 365 or something. But that's not the whole picture, and there's a lot more data in there. But I wanted to find out what the best place was to explore it and to actually access it. The Azure portal, which is one place that you can explore all these things, is something that can be disabled. So if the portal is disabled, can we still get all the data? And where is the low-level Azure AD data stored? Because we know that there's obviously a lot of backend data or data used by internal Microsoft applications, but we don't know where this is stored or how this is used. And finally, how does Azure AD actually work? Because it's a cloud thing and it just does stuff, but nobody knows exactly how. So that's what some things that I tried to answer. And I started looking at the ways that actually are to interact with Azure AD. Now, the first and most obvious one is probably the Azure portal. And the Azure portal is quite nice. We'll be using it a bit during these talks or during the stream, and I'll have a look at it. But the portal also simplifies a lot of the concepts and tries to hide things from you sometimes, which is pretty weird. So it's not the best place to actually find out or figure out stuff. There are also some PowerShell modules and some .NET libraries. And these offer varying kind of functionalities. And not all of them have the same level of support. Not all of them have the same level of details available. And not all of them are as easy to use. And for example, you can't really use PowerShell on Linux or the PowerShell Azure modules or the .NET libraries, which is kind of hard. Also, these modules ultimately use some APIs. So using the APIs directly is far more likely to get us more information than using a library, which has always limited support on top of the API. Not the portal, PowerShell modules, also not not the libraries, at least the APIs. The question is, which API? Because there are quite a lot of them. And when you look at, for example, the Azure portal, it talks to the Azure portal API. But what does the Azure portal API talk to? Is there some internal API, or does it talk to the Azure AD graph or the Microsoft graph? And ultimately, what do these graphs talk to? Do they talk directly to a database, or is there some other protocol in there? I don't know. Actually, still don't know. But what I do know is that I was once looking at the portal, and I suddenly saw it requesting some interesting data, and that was going to an API version called 1.61 internal. And this returned quite some different data than I was used from seeing, because it contained a lot more detail. And I looked a bit into that. And of course, calling an API internal is kind of like painting a red flag for me, like, hey, this is internal. You're totally not supposed to look here. So what do? I look there. And it turns out that there is quite some interesting information in there. And that sometimes the Azure portal just bypasses the Azure portal API and talks directly to the internal Azure AD API. I still don't know what these APIs talk to, but I assume there's some kind of backend cloud database behind it all. So the conclusion is that as an attacker or researcher or even blue teamer, you probably want to be looking at the internal Azure AD graph, since it exposes the most data. So that's one thing solved. Of course, the problem with this is that these graphs don't have official supported modules, since it's the internal version. So you're kind of left writing your own framework. And that's what I did. So I wrote a framework called RoadTools. And the first tool of RoadTools is RoadRecon, which is a tool to really explore all that data. And I set myself some goals. I wanted it to be a tool for both red teaming and for blue teaming, to explore really all the data that I could get my hands on. So whether or not it was, or whether or not you're supposed to officially access it, I wanted to get it all, dump it all, and analyze it all. This also helped with finding some things that were obviously not intended functionalities. So there were some interesting vulnerabilities or unintended effects from all the data that was available in the internal version. So this is also a great tool that I used during my own research. And I also really wanted to show the wealth of information that's available there. Because like on-prem, Active Directory, any authenticated user can query all this information. And if there's one leaked set of credentials or one successful password spray, then it's very hard to hide that data, since everyone is supposed to access it, and the whole of Office 365 kind of relies on accessing all this data. So once you have one valid set of credentials as a red teamer, you can dump all this information and you can get all the information about the Azure AD tenant that you're looking at. I also wanted to improve understanding of how Azure AD works, some of the terminology, some of the things under the hood, and what the possibilities are with it. And lastly, I wanted to provide a framework rather than a tool, so that it's not just me building something, but it's also easy for others to make something that builds on this framework. So it's I also made like a possibility to make plugins, so that if I make a tool that can extract data from this framework, then you can also write a tool that talks to the framework and then uses the existing code in order to gather the same information or to perform some analysis that's useful to you and maybe not to anyone else. But I wanted to make it down to write not much code to get some functionality, and I'll show that later. So the framework right now consists of two parts. There's the RoadLib, which is a library, and there's also RoadRecon, which is the first tool. So RoadLib handles all the authentication. It also handles the metadata, so it knows how Azure stores its data, and it also has a definition, and it also has the whole database definition that RoadRecon uses in the backend. So if you want to build a tool that uses some components of this framework, but not all of it, then you only have to import the library part and not the whole recon tool, because the recon tool obviously depends on a lot of more tools and projects. So it's a much larger install size, and you may not want to include all that. The recon tool does data gathering, data analysis, and it does some conversion, because you first have to get the data and then do something useful with it and convert it to a useful format. There's also a front-end interface built in Angular that I spent way too much time on, and I was really like, oh, this Angular, this is terrible. But now I finally understand it a little bit. And once you understand it, it's quite, well, I wouldn't dare calling it fun, but you can get some interesting things with it. And there's also future tools. I have some ideas for things that I want to build, which will fit into the framework and will hopefully be easier to build now that the basics are already here. I also got some experience of how not to do this. Maybe some of you are familiar with one of my first tools that I started with, which is LDAP Domain Dump, which was written for on-prem AD. And it basically dumps all the information from AD to disk. And then it tries to first calculate some interesting things like the recursive group memberships. It calculates which user is a member of which group. And also, if that group is a member of another group, then it also adds to that group. So it has a single overview of which user is in which groups and which groups are they in. And that's all in one single file. Well, that works for smaller environments. As the environments get bigger, then it scales pretty badly because it keeps all the data, literally everything from LDAP that it can get, it keeps in memory, and then it starts using more than 10 gigabytes of memory. So I did it different this time. I actually separated the steps that it used to dump. So first it authenticates. Obviously, it needs a way to access the information. And the goal is to, in the end, enable any method possible authentication. So username and password, or a certificate, or a token of a user that you acquired somehow. The end goal is to support it all. It's not already yet, but there are quite some possibilities which may help you bypass, for example, some access policies that were set on authentication. The second stage is the dumping. So then it stores all the data offline, and it doesn't try to do any analysis with it. It just gathers everything and immediately stores that to disk in a structured format. And the third step is actually analyzing it. It then performs offline analysis on the data, and the separation between those steps means that it doesn't have to perform everything in memory. It can do analysis after it's dumped. So if you decide, okay, I want to analyze this now instead of something I did previously, you don't have to dump the data anymore because you already have that offline, and you can keep it offline indefinitely. So if you are on a red team and you're you get a credential and you dump that information, then you have that available for the whole of the assignment. And even if the user gets blocked, you can still go back to the information that you already had and maybe perform a new analysis on it. So I'll give a short overview of the three steps. start with authentication. And when you try to authenticate against the Microsoft Graph or the Azure AD Graph, then the first step is that you have to have an application. And if you read the Microsoft documentation, the first step says register your application. Okay, so that's obviously something that I don't necessarily want to do. Because if I'm a red teamer, I don't have access to the environment. So I am not allowed to access to register an application. Maybe sometimes you don't have the privileges because it's possible to lock down who can register an application. A lot of companies are doing that because you probably don't want all your users to be able to register applications at will. So I looked at abusing an existing application because Office 365 already installs like 200 applications by default when you create a new tenant. So there are probably a lot of applications that we can abuse. And if an application authenticates, there are two parts involved. So the first is the service principle, and the second is the definition of the app. And the these two parts define all the rights that the applications have and the authentication methods, also the URLs that are allowed to be used in authentication. So let's just have a look. Go to the portal here. This is the Azure portal. And I go to Azure Active Directory. I'm signed in with my primary account. It's a global admin, so it's allowed to do anything. And I can see a lot of applications here. And some of these applications are custom applications. And you can really see which permissions these applications have. So for example, the test application, it has the permission to read all the applications and read directory data in the Microsoft Graph. So these are some permissions of the test application that I have here. And if I authenticate using that test application, then it will only give me access to this information because that's the security model that applications use. And that means that I have to find an application that's actually allowed to access the information that I want. Okay, so the applications have a definition of the rights that they have and the valid authentication methods. And the authentication methods also are different for different types of applications. I'll get to that later. And if applications authenticate you, then they get they use the OAuth2 protocol and get a JSON web token to authenticate the user against one of the APIs. So in order to understand all this, we got to zoom in a bit on the OAuth2 protocol because that describes a lot of flows. And some of these flows that require that you actually have credentials, but then you need to prove that you are the applications that you pretend to be. And some of them require only the application ID because these applications are not secured applications and they don't have secrets. So for example, the PowerShell AD module, I have that somewhere here. So if I open PowerShell and I have the Azure AD module installed, so I should be able to do connect Azure AD. So then it gives a pop-up and it signs me in. But the Azure PowerShell application, it's an application that exists locally on my machine. So it doesn't have any secrets with that it can prove that it's actually the Azure PowerShell AD module. And this is called a public client in OAuth2 principles. So that means that there are no secrets involved. And the PowerShell Azure AD module has actually impersonation rights on the Azure AD graph. And it means that it can do anything that the user can also do. So that's like having full rights on the Azure AD graph. But because there's no way to prove that we are actually the PowerShell Azure AD module, we can just take its application ID and use that to sign the user in. And then we will also have these permissions of the PowerShell Azure AD module. So one of the ways to do this is the password grant flow. Officially, it's called the Resource Owner Password Credentials Grant Flow, which is a whole mouthful. But it actually means if an application has your password, then it can log in using your username and password. And then it also provides its application ID in order to convert that username and password into an access token for these APIs. It does not support MFA because it's only username password. And just there's no, if there's MFA on the account, then you cannot use this method. This is a really simple example. You just post this to login at Microsoft Online. You say grant types password. You specify the scope of the access that you want. Yeah, you specify the client ID, which is in this case, I think the PowerShell client ID. And you specify the resource, which is graph.windows.net for the Azure AD graph. Then you specify the password, username, and you get back a token. And with that token, you can then call the Azure AD graph and access anything that you want. Actually, it gives you three tokens. The first one is the access token. And the access token is the token that's actually used to access the graph, which is pretty obvious. And the second one is a refresh token. And the refresh token is valid much longer than the access token, because the access token is only valid for 1 hour. But the refresh token is valid for much longer, sometimes even indefinitely. But I think by default it's valid for 90 days. And the refresh token can be used to request new access tokens. Lastly, there's also the ID token. And the ID token is a token for the application that you're using instead of for the graph that you are accessing. So the ID token is not really interesting in our case, but the access token and the refresh token are. And if you look at these tokens, then you can, these are simply JSON web tokens. So you can decode them, and it also specifies whether you were authenticated with only a password or whether you used MFA. And then it also says, in this case, the scope, and the scope of the Azure AD, the scope of the the Azure PowerShell AD module gets is the user impersonation, at least for the two graph APIs. So that's all reflected in that access token. And I looked a bit at different applications, because the PowerShell app ID is quite well known. So the vendors may be looking for that in their logs. And if you suddenly sign in using the PowerShell API, then that might be a sign that there's something wrong with the account, especially if it's someone that never uses PowerShell or that's done for a weird IP. So they may be looking for that in logging. So I was wondering, are there any other default applications that have the same user impersonation privileges? And it turns out there are. And this is like a short list of all the applications that there are. And they have permissions to basically access the graph, the Microsoft graph or the Azure AD graph with exactly the same permissions as that the user has. So if you're trying to hide your tracks and don't want to use the default Azure AD PowerShell module ID, then you might want to pick one of these apps and it will get you the same result. And once again, to use this password grant or to use this password grant authentication flow, It doesn't require you to prove that you process the app, that you are actually the application that you say you are. So you can use any app ID with the right permissions, and you can interact with the APIs with all the permissions that the regular user has. And we can use Azure AD PowerShell module if we would want that without using the PowerShell app ID. And if the vendors are then looking for actions performed with the Azure AD PowerShell module and we use a different app ID, it would make the life of the defender much harder. So this is an example. Here I access the Microsoft graph, which is the very useful and readable GUID on top. You'll see a lot of these IDs because everything in Azure AD is basically a GUID. And on the bottom, you see the application ID that was used, which is, I think, the Microsoft MyLiQ application. I don't even know what it does, but I've definitely never seen that legitimately. So these are some interesting things that you can basically try to fly under the radar if people are looking at specific events. So if we don't have, if we don't just have the username and password, but there's also MFA required, then there's a different OAuth flow that we can use. That's the device code flow. So this is basically mostly intended for devices or operating systems that don't support the browser pop-up that we just saw for the Azure PowerShell module. And it basically gives you a device code, and then you link your account to that specific sign-on. And it also will prompt you for MFA. And I'll show this in a bit. Lastly, there is the, well, not lastly, but there's also another flow which involves an authorization code. This is actually a much more common flow than the previous two. And most native or web applications will use this flow, where the user authenticates on a website, the application gets an authorization code, and the application then uses that authorization code and exchanges for a session token, so an access token and a refresh token. And if the application is a non-public application, so it's, for example, a web application, then it will require a secret to prove that it's actually that application. And then the authorization code is quite useless, because without the secret, you can't exchange that authorization code for an actual token. If it's a public client, such as native desktop applications or mobile applications, then you can exchange the authorization code directly for the session, for the access code or a refresh token. And you don't require a secret. So once again, in this flow, you can use any application that has this available and is a public client. This is kind of an overview, not very interesting. And this is how it looks, because when you use the connect Azure AD commandlet, it basically opens like a built-in browser, and after it detects the redirect to a specific URL, then it will grab the authorization code from there, exchange that for a token, and then you're authenticated. There's a last one, which is the implicit grant. And if you have a web application without a backend, so for example, a single page JavaScript application, then the access token is sent directly to the URL of the application. And to limit the possibilities with this, there's a whitelist of URLs that this can be sent to. So for example, a web version of Microsoft Teams, there are kind of whitelisted URLs that this token is sent to, and this only involves the access token, so no refresh token. This is less useful because the access token is only valid for 1 hour, and to renew it, you would have to send the user back to the login page and then forward it to your application again. So you have only 1 hour to perform your actions. So it's a bit less useful if you want to use this authentication code or steal an access token, but it's still possible to obtain one and use that with RoadTools. So to summarize, if you get an authentication token somewhere or somehow, you can access the Graph API. And then what you can access with that depends on the permissions of the application that you used. And for Road Recon, you will need an application that requires user impersonation because it tries to access any aspect from the graph that it can get. There's a last limit, and that is that only Microsoft applications can access the internal graph. So you have to abuse one of the applications that Microsoft publishes, which is usually not an issue since there are quite a few of them. All right, so that was it for authentication. Just want to talk shortly about the relationships and the database and the design of that. And I will do that not here, but I will do that here. So we start Chrome. And what Microsoft used for the Azure AD graph and also for the Microsoft graph is something called OData. And that is kind of a concept that makes descriptive APIs. And the advantage of that is that it has like a metadata definition that you can get, which describes the entire graph. And it describes all the entities in it, for example. So here we have the entity type application. And you can see all the properties that an application has in the Azure AD graph. And we... Come on. And if we scroll further, we can also see that an application has some navigation properties. So these are connections to other entities. And the idea is that with this, you can build an whole application in a kind of automated way. And there are also some .NET libraries for OData so that you can create a whole data model based on this. I also tried to get this working with some of the Python OData libraries, which wasn't really fruitful because I couldn't really figure out how it actually worked, and there's hardly any documentation on this whole OData thing. And I think the only native bindings that they published were like obscure old version of Visual Studio that I couldn't even download anymore. So that wasn't really successful. But still, this thing describes the whole metadata model, and the whole everything that's offered by the Microsoft Graph. So I wrote some code myself that basically parses this document. So it reads the whole XML document and then reads all the entity types, and this is some very ugly code. You don't need to look at this, but in the end, this will generate a whole database model. And the database model is ORM, so it's object relational mapping. I don't know. It's something that SQL Alchemy is used. So you basically define your classes, and these are generated fully automatically. So all the properties are coming from this XML, and it also looks which types of data there is in there. And it creates this for all the entity types that are supported. So if we look at the service principle, we see all these properties, and we also see some relationships defined. So like service principle can have an owner, and then with this link, we basically create a link between a service principle and a user object, so that SQL Alchemy can then create this link in the database. And with this automatically generated database model, SQL Alchemy can create the database for us. So we don't actually need to worry about writing SQL queries or injections or whatever, because we just use the Python objects, and how they are stored in the backend is fully handled by SQL Alchemy. And at the moment, it supports two backends. The first one is SQLite, which is a really simple database model. It doesn't require any additional libraries since it's built in Python. And it's just stored it very simply on disk. And the second one is Postgres. So with Postgres, if you prefer that, you can also use the same code to put everything in Postgres and query it from there. It also gives you some more possibilities to use a database that you have somewhere in on a server or something, if you want to work together with the data set. Let's see. So the database is based on the XML model. This also makes it easy to update database if there's a change. I just need to download the new metadata XML, then run two scripts, and then we have a fully new database model compatible with the latest version. Dumping the data is kind of straightforward. It just visits all the endpoints of the Microsoft Graph and just tries to dump all the objects to disk. This dumping happens in two phases, and these two phases run in parallel. Well, no, the tasks within the phases run in parallel. There's a reason for that. And what I use for this is Async.io HTTP, which is a framework to write asynchronous Python code and make sure that you don't end up waiting for all the data to come back over HTTP all the time. And this does make the tool Python 3.6 actually only. It's written 3.7 here, but it's 3.6. And it is quite fast. It can perform thousands of HTTP requests in just a couple of minutes. And it flushes the data that it gets from the HTTP API to the database in chunks. So the memory usage is kept as low as possible. Unfortunately, it's still limited by the API logic, because if you request the users in the Microsoft Graph, you can only request up to 1,000 users at a time. And in that response, so with the first 1,000 users, it will post a token, and that token you can use to request the next 1,000 users. But of course, if you want to dump all the users, then you still have to wait for all the previous users to come in before you can request the next chunk. So it's still something that's done in serial. Unfortunately, there's not really a way around that. But still, it's if you want to dump all the users and all the groups at the same time, then you can at least do both at the same time and not have to dump all the users first before you dump all the groups. And I think that was already the end of the slides. So we look a bit at the dumping logic. And after, I'll of course give a demo. This is the getter file. It's actually quite short. It's only about 400 lines of code that I've rewritten like three times. So it didn't start this way, and there's still some things that I would like to change with that. So here you see the first phase. So it just creates some tasks, and it dumps all the objects. So it will dump the users, the tenant details, policies, service principles, groups, applications, etc. And it will start all those simultaneously. And of course, this will depend on the slowest, which really depends on your organization. But usually that will be either the users or the groups, whichever you have more of. And that will take the longest. So you'll have to wait for all the users that are finished before it can start phase two. Because in phase two, it actually queries all the relationships between the objects. And before it can query, or then that can create the links then the objects must be in the database first. So you can't say, hey, this user is a member of this group if you have not stored the group data yet. So that's why all the objects have to be dumped first. And then we can actually visit all the groups and collect all their members and link those together. That is actually done in parallel. So here it will just, for every group request its members. So if you have 10,000 groups, that also means at least 10,000 requests. It's, I don't know if why they didn't make a generic dump all group members, which would have been nice, but they probably didn't intend this usage of their graph. So that would be a possible reason. So this dumps a lot of stuff. And you can also dump the MFA status of users, which for technical reasons also requires you to request this for each individual user. So if you have 50,000 users, then it will issue 50,000 requests. So it grows quite fast. All right. I think I'll just start with a demo. This was my Windows VM, and now switching back to Ubuntu. And I hope this all works. I already pushed the packages to PyPy actually, slightly before this talk. And let's hope that works. When I work with Python things, I usually try to use a virtual env just to prevent any things messing up. And in this case, I use pipenv to manage this virtual environment, and it's using Python 3.8. So I can just install RoadRecon, which will automatically install RoadLib, and which will install all the dependencies as well. And you see there are quite some dependencies, but if I only wanted to write a tool that interacts with the database, I would only need to install RoadLib, so that would have not that many dependencies. And I can run RoadRecon. It adds a tool or a command to your path. And I try to keep all the options very simple. So these reflect the three steps that we just described. First, you authenticate, then you gather the information, and then you explore the information that's there. So let's have a look at the authentication options. There are quite a few of those, and this is because I want to support all the scenarios that I just mentioned. All the different OAuth authentication scenarios are in the end something that I want to support. In most cases, you don't actually need most of these things. So let's just start with RoadRecon and one of my test users, and I just enter, I forgot to say auth, and let me go to my key pass. So now I just gave it the username and password, and it automatically used the OAuth password grant flow to authenticate, and it saved the tokens to disk. I know this is not something you always want to do. That's why there's also an option to instead pipe them directly to the next command. But the reason that I write them to disk is that this contains a refresh token as well, which is valid for a very long time. And this way you don't have to trigger a login again, because every time you do this, then there is a login event generated. If you instead use the refresh token that's now written on disk, there is no new login event. It just counts as an extension of the current session. So you can keep using these credentials for a long time. And also, I really wanted to decouple each step from each other. And I didn't want to have a tool where you have to specify 1,000 things on the command line and do everything at the same time. And like this, you only have to focus on one thing at a time. So first you do the authentication, then you do the dumping, and then you do the actual data analysis. So what I also can do is use the device code flow. I think that doesn't need any requirements. So I can simply go to this page and then enter this code. And you see this says you'll be signed into the Azure Active Directory PowerShell, because that's the thing that we use at the moment. And then you do the regular flow and it says you've signed in. And on the background, it writes the tokens again to the RoadTools auth. And I just look at this, what's in here. You see that there's an access token. And this is a JSON web token. I hope none of you is quick enough to type it over and steal my account, but I'll trust you on this. Which I can paste into the JWT debugger, which is one of my favorite extensions for dealing with this. And what you see here is that we do indeed have the user impersonation. And you see also the that is a token for the Azure AD graph, and that it was issued to the PowerShell application ID. And I didn't use any MFA, so my authentication methods were just my passwords. So if I was to I try to use this token to access something that needed multi-factor authentication, then this would fail because it doesn't have the multi-factor authentication claim in the access token. So the next step is dumping all the data. Let's see if that works. It takes the token from disk and it dumps it in two phases. And you can see that already finished. So it did these almost 500 HTTP requests in 3.5 seconds, which is pretty fast in my opinion. Thanks to that, everything happens asynchronously. And now we have everything in the database. Let's see if I can find the database. So in this case, it's a SQLite database, which has the .db extension. And we can see here that everything here is basically present. And to answer a question from the chat, is this API rate limited? I haven't encountered any rate limits yet. And trust me, I've shot plenty of requests at this. So it doesn't seem to be rate limited yet. Of course, if you start running this the entire day, then I think they will at some point have quite some requests. But I haven't run into rate limiting yet. And that's also the reason why I want to dump everything offline. So if I lose access or if there's some rate limiting, then I don't need to request the data live all the time. So we can query all the information in the database. So here are all the users, and you see that there are a lot of properties in there. This is still not very useful for analysis because it's just too much scrolling. And here are also all the link tables. And the link tables, they contain a lot of GUIDs, so they're also kind of hard to use. Good thing that you were not meant to use this, because I wrote a GUI to explore all this. Let's hope that works. Yes. So here is the interface. It actually runs as a single page JavaScript application. So this is all the HTML source code, and the rest is all Angular and with the Angular material design. And what I really wanted to do is create something that is available for an easy overview, but that also offers all the details. So for most of the things that are in there, there will also always be a view raw or view function that you can view the JSON object that's actually in the database directly. And it also has syntax highlighting, so it makes it a bit easier to use. So what can you see in here? Well, let's start with the users. So for example, these are all my users. I can see whether they're enabled, what their email is, department, job title, mobile. And in this case, there's not really a lot of data in the database because this is a pretty small tenant. But if you run this on a real company, there's tons of interesting data in there. Like you can see everyone's job title, department, you can see what they do, which also translates to which applications they likely have access to if you're on a red team and your goal is to access specific applications. And you can also see here which account type is in use. So in this case, this account is a cloud only account, and these are all synced from on-prem AD. If I click on one of those, I can see a small overview, some more properties. I can see the groups that they're a member of and which roles that they're a member of. In this case, it's not a member of any roles. You can also see the objects that it owns. So this user owns an Android device, which is a Nexus 5X, which happens to be laying on my desk here somewhere. And you can also see the raw view that we discussed earlier. So all the properties that are not in here, and all the properties that you may want to look at, or if you're just interested in this, then you can use the raw view. And some interesting things that we can see here are, for example, the on-premise security identifier. This is the security identifier from Active Directory that the user has. And this is the distinguished name. So then you can also see from only information in Azure AD, you can see which OU this is in, for example. And that also says something about the on-prem directory structure. And the fact that this data is present means that it's actually an account that's synced from AD. And there's a lot of more things. Not that interesting. So here's the groups view. The groups are pretty straightforward. You can also see whether they're client only or synced from AD. If it's Office 365 mail group, it will usually have an email address assigned, but I didn't do too much in this tenant, so there's not too much there. You can also see which users are a member of the group. And what also feature is that you can then again click on that user and then you immediately get the pop-up for that user. So you can really easily click through all the principles that are there and navigate between them and say, oh, this user is in this group. Oh, what's that group and what are the properties of that group? And if you close it, it will try to go back to the previous one that you were. That's not extremely reliable. Sometimes it's a bit weird with the pop-ups, but it works pretty well. These are the devices. So everyone owns a device. These can be servers, these can be clients. And in this case, you see that there, for example, an application server, which is running Windows 10, it says here, but I think it's actually server 2016, but okay. And the trust type is server AD. So this is a device in on-prem AD that is synchronized to Azure AD. You can also see this mobile device, which is workplace trust. So that means that it's enrolled via Intune. And you can also see that this is a compliant device. It's managed and it thinks it's not rooted, which it actually is, but. So nice is that Angular Material allows you to sort these things. So if you only want, if you want to sort this, then it works. And if you want to filter on anything, so for example, you only want Windows devices, the default filtering really filters on any field that there is. So you can filter on the OS or the version or the trust type or whatever. And it also filters on fields that you don't see. So I think that if I search for the object ID, so if you find an object ID somewhere, you can also filter on that and it will show you actually only that object. Even though it's not a property that's shown here, it's a property that it knows because it's returned by the Flask API that powers this front end. So you can filter on that. And that makes it really easy to actually find objects if you're looking somewhere and seeing, hey, what is this object ID again? Another useful feature, or at least I think is a useful feature, is an overview of all the privileged roles in a directory. Microsoft doesn't offer this. If you look in the Azure portal, then you really have to go through all the roles individually to get the members, and it's a lot of clicking. And this just gives you a single page overview. As long as my browser is not going to crash. Maybe I should have given this one more RAM. Nah, 2 gigs is enough. So one thing I did not collect because I was running with a simple account is the MFA status. So there's actually an option here that makes it show the MFA column, and then every user gets an extra column whether they have MFA enabled. And this is the only thing that you can't query as a regular user. It requires it requires either security reader or directory. There's some other, or user account administrator, they can query this information, but not regular users. So therefore it's not queried by default. But if I run this again, So if I add as as my global admin, actually what I can do is just to show you that's not running now. And I wanted to show that I can use a different app ID, but I guess I'll do that later. So I just re-authenticated and then I dumped the data, and there's actually a different flag that I can use, which is -- MFA. Then you can dump all the MFA data. So this is also an option. You can also change the database if you don't want it to be on disk. By default, it's rodrigon.db, but you can also change that to Postgres, as I discussed. But let's dump the MFA data. I think that when I start the GUI now, there's one question in the chat, how I went to learning those libraries. Yes, I am going to change that password. Well, for a lot of libraries, I do read the documentation, but it's also a lot of trial and error. For the Azure AD graph, I actually went mostly by just requesting all the endpoints. because they're not documented because it's the internal version. And I basically try to look at all the properties and which ones were useful and filtering that in order to find something that was useful to display in the UI. All right, I did dump the MFA and I hope that now, yes. So if I go to directory roles, then I see here that this user actually has MFA. So you can see, as you can see, the it has a notification and it has OTP setup. There's also a specific page for MFA where you can see it for all the users, and you can filter them on the number of MFA methods they have registered, and you can also see what their default option is. So for this user, they have registered their phone number and the default option is a text message, and for the other users they have a notification set as default. You can also see that this Yubi user has Fido set up. So that is a YubiKey. So this user authenticates with a YubiKey. And actually this you can also query as a regular user. The reason for that is when you look at the raw fields, there is a field called searchable device key, which lists some of the keys that users have. And here you can see the public certificate of the YubiKey that I registered in this account. And this is queryable by any user. And to query this, so you don't need a privileged user. And to answer the question, which endpoints I used, and there's no specific endpoint, but you have to use the internal version of the Azure AD graph. And then you have to request each user individually. And you have to request the strong authentication detail property. So that's where the MFA is stored. And here you can see that there's a phone app notification and OTP setup. And I can also see that which phone this is activated on, for example. So this is the this is, as far as I know, only available in the internal version of the Azure AD graph. And to answer the question from Tifkin, no, I did not do any collection for Azure Resource Manager objects yet. The reason for that is that for this, I really stuck to the Azure AD graph, and the Azure AD graph only shows Azure AD properties and not things for Azure Resource Manager or other Office 365 applications. I am thinking about also incorporating other things, especially because the Azure AD graph is officially deprecated. I don't think they'll stop using it anytime soon, but the API that's mostly developed is the Microsoft graph. However, the Microsoft graph is very complex and it covers like all of the Microsoft services, so it's very hard to create a useful database model for that. And also it doesn't have like this secret internal version that offers a lot more detail. So in the directory roles overview, we see that a lot of users here don't have MFA, but it's bad. If you see that at the client, definitely tell them. My next favorite part is the applications. As I mentioned a lot of times in my public talks, this is actually not very clear in the Microsoft graph because it mentions applications and enterprise applications, or app registrations and enterprise applications. And enterprise applications is kind of a weird name, but what I mean with enterprise applications are service principles. So applications in this case are only the applications that are registered in this tenant. So the application that I registered myself. And if you then look at the service principles, these are all the applications that are actually present in the tenant and have a security object. So these are actually identities in this tenant. I can also filter, sort and see which ones are Microsoft applications. And you can also see whether they are applications from a different publisher, for example. So for this, you can easily see how many passwords an application has assigned, for example. So in this case, only the P2P server application has a password assigned or a credential. And this is also interesting because for Microsoft applications, they're not supposed to have a password assigned. I have seen Microsoft applications with certificates assigned, so that seems to happen. But if you have a password assigned to a Microsoft first party application, then there is a chance that that's someone that backdoored it. It's one of my favorite backdoor methods because passwords of service principals that are from Microsoft don't show up in the graph because the graph doesn't offer you a method to actually assign credentials to this. But it's kind of easy to spot this if you do it, if you're using the right tools. There's two service principals that I actually wanted to highlight. So one of those is the device registration service. And the interesting thing about service principals is that if you're an application admin, you get control over all these service principals. And sometimes some of the engineers were like, oh, I need to store a state somewhere, data or something, the settings regarding the tenant. And they actually use a service principal for that. So in the device registration service, there's a metadata field. And that's basically a field that's just parsed from this app metadata, because in the app metadata, the values are encoded, base64 and then JSON again. So I just made an easier method to decode those. And here you see that the admin configuration actually shows you the policies for devices that are joined to Azure AD. So if you join a device to Azure AD, these are the security identifiers that will be in the local admin group. And if you're an application admin, you can actually change this metadata, and you can change who will become admin on the devices. So that's definitely something that's not intended, but you can still change this as an application admin. Another one that I haven't talked about before, which was it? Yes, the Microsoft Password Reset service. So this one has the self-service password policy metadata. And if we go to the Azure portal, then the, where is the password reset? Oh, it's actually the wrong user. The Azure portal is kind of heavy on my laptop. So what you actually see here is I'm using the Firefox containers extension, which helps me separate the different users. So now I'm in the Azure admin container, which is an admin in my Azure AD. And the other container is just a regular user. So here for password reset, you can configure which users are allowed to password reset, how many methods that are required, and you can even, I think, define some security questions. But these settings are actually stored on this object. So here you see the policy. So if it's enabled and which methods are allowed, required. And these can also be changed by an application admin. I'm not sure if there's much use for it because it doesn't allow for privilege escalation, but it's definitely something that's unintended. And this data that's here, the app metadata, is only accessible via the internal version. So normally you wouldn't see this, and you can't see this in the portal. Because if you go to the enterprise application for the self-service, I can't even find it. Here it is. But it doesn't show you any of these properties. So this is quite useful for analysis. Two more things. One is the application roles. So what you can see here is all the applications, or actually the service principles, that were granted privileges, either in an application or to a third-party application. So let's see, if I filter on Microsoft Graph, then you can see all the applications that have permissions on the Microsoft Graph. So test app can read all directory data and can access media streams in a call as an app. This is more useful for blue teams to analyze which applications have which permissions. It's a simple overview. You can filter it, you can sort it, and I think it's pretty useful. Same goes for delegated permissions or OAuth2 permissions. You can see which users granted an application impersonation permissions, for example. So see, these are individual users that granted an application permissions interactively, and these are permissions that were granted by an actual admin, so for all the whole tenant. This is also a way to detect maybe third-party applications that were inadvertently given access to any of your directory data. So again, useful for red teams, but definitely more useful for blue teams. I think that's mostly it from the GUI. Are there any more questions about this? Let's see. Which endpoint I use according to service principles? Yes, that is the service principles endpoint. No. Let me just restart this virtual machine. Apparently I've been too long in the Ubuntuverse. And yeah, it just used the, it uses the service principles endpoint. All right, so we've seen the GUI. I think I've showed everything I wanted there. Something I haven't shown yet is a different feature that I worked on, which is related to policies. So if you use the database, you can actually see that I can access quite some policies. This isn't possible in the official version of the graph, but if you use the internal version, then any authenticated user can query all your policies. And policies can mean conditional access policies, but can also mean the trusted networks that you have set up, or some other policies regarding to Office or stuff. So there's quite some interesting data in there. And as a red teamer, I think this is one of the most interesting things that you want to explore, because it will show you exactly what you can or cannot access using accounts in Azure, and what kind of requirements there are. So there is a plugin, and it also shows the plugin part. So RoadRecon supports plugins, and plugins can be really simple things and also can be really complex things. But this policies plugin is basically just something that parses these conditional access policies and outputs that into a graph. So if I run this, it doesn't actually show you anything, but it does give me a HTML file. And here's a list of all the conditional access policies that exist. So you see, for example, this conditional access policy MFA for Office, then all the users that are in this group need MFA when accessing Office 365 applications. And the same for these things. These have some additional requirements, such as a compliant device, or a domain join device, and these are all set in conditional access policies. So here you can really see which policies are applied on which sign-in and on which platforms and which groups are covered by those. I do want to add those to the GUI, but it's quite a bit of things, so I have to spend some more time exploring how Angular actually works, and then I'll probably also port this to the interface. To answer Olaf's question, do I have recommendations to mitigate against collection? There is one option which allows you to configure the directory to disallow this data collection. It's a feature of only the Microsoft Online PowerShell module, and you can basically deny authenticated users from listing all this information. This is not available in the portal, and I don't know how well things like Office 365 will work with this, because I haven't seen Microsoft advertise this anywhere, and the whole concept of Office 365 is that it integrates with everything, and you can see all your colleagues, and you can query all the properties. So there is a method. I don't know what it will break, and I don't know for how long Microsoft will actually support that. I hope that answers the question. And someone mentioned Bloodhound. And yes, there is a Bloodhound plugin. So what this actually does... there is an interface, and there is a way to export this data to Bloodhound. And for that, I would normally have to figure out how to install Bloodhound, or how to convince Neo4j to listen on external interface. I'm not going to do that, so I will just quickly copy this database over to the Windows VM, where I have Neo4j installed. So you see this SQLite database is really portable. And I could also run RoadRecon here because I installed it using Python. And I should be able to do is I have a custom version of Bloodhound here. So this Bloodhound version supports Azure AD. I hope it works. And I can basically run the plugin Bloodhound, and it will probably tell me to install something. Yes. So I first have to install the Neo4j driver. I hope that works on Windows. Right, so this seems to work. And what it did now, I wrote a relatively simple plugin. And so let's have a look at the plugin first. This is all there is to a plugin. This is a little over 200 lines. Every plugin has a main function, and that basically imports the arguments. So every plugin needs at least a database file. Every plugin should specify which additional arguments it needs. In this case, it adds the database options to connect to Neo4j, and it describes the plugin description. So that's really all that's required for a plugin. And apart from that, it just imports the database from Rotlib, and it imports the objects that it wants to query. And after that, It just gets a connection to the database. That's one line of code. And you can start querying objects. And querying objects is also really simple. This one line just queries all the users in the database. And that uses the SQL Alchemy code to query the database that you specified, and all the queries that are there are actually performed for you. So it's really easy. And all that this code does is read the objects from the database and then convert them into Neo4j queries, which will write them into Bloodhound. So what I already did was load the on-prem information in here. I collected that earlier, so it has the Kubernetes domains and groups. And there's this little thing for the Azure AD specific queries. So here I can query all the role members. So this is a very similar overview of what you saw earlier in the GUI, and you can see all these users that are a member of this role. So this user is company admin, which is the alternative name for global administrator. And you see also the service principals that are a member of a role. Something you can also do is like find service principals with custom owners. So these are some service principals that have a custom owner set. By default, only global admins and application admins can edit a service principal. But if you set an owner to a service principal, then that user also gets privileges to add credentials to that service principal or modify some of the properties. And this way, if you have a service principal that is a member of a privileged role, and that service principal has an owner, then the owner of that service principal is indirectly actually a member of that role. And that could be quite interesting. So in this case, there's not really any escalation paths that were there. But something you can also see, some escalation paths that are there is also like this. So here, Joe Biz has the user account administrator role. And you see here that we can query the information from Joe Biz, but we can also see that this account is linked to an on-prem account. And this is just the regular Bloodhound data, which now crashes. Let's see what went wrong there. Nothing. Okay, let's just see if we can refresh it. All right. Back to your role members. I think something is broken. Let's see if I can query this another way. Now I use the shortest path query. So I select the user account administrator, and this queries a path. And you can see that this combines the Azure AD data with the on-prem AD data. So here's the user account administrator, and Joe is actually a member of that role. But the on-prem account of Joe, which is syncing to this account, so it shares a password, or it holds a session. It really depends on the setup. That account, these are actually the same accounts. So if you compromise this account on-prem and have its password, then you can become a user account administrator. Or if you have the hash, then you can possibly also use single sign-on via Kerberos or something. And if you have this user, which is a domain admin, then you can obviously manage Joe. There are some more paths in here. So at the moment, I didn't really have the time to collect session data. But if you imagine that that there's a session from the user Joe, then you could add then you could see a path like someone who is admin on the workstation of Joe, and that someone would be able to get an access token from Joe. For example, on this Windows 10 workstation, actually, I am this workstation is joined to AD, but it's a hybrid environment. So just to show you that, so this is very useful in hybrid environments. So this shows you the DSRAG CMD, and it says that this device is both domain joined and Azure AD joined. And what it means is that it will have automatic single sign-on, even in Chrome, because I have this nice extension installed. So if I would be an admin on this workstation, I could use single sign-on to actually access Azure. And in this case, Azure Directory. And in this case, what is also interesting is when I look at the sources here, then I go to this roles, then you'll see that, won't see that. What I'm looking for is, because this the Azure portal sometimes also does calls to the Microsoft graph. Come on. Yes, so here we actually see a call to the Microsoft graph. Let me pop this out. Yes. So here the Azure portal performed a call to the Microsoft graph. And here we see an access token. And you could imagine that if I had access to this machine, I would find a way to actually obtain this access token. And this access token is valid for the Microsoft graph. So I could then impersonate this mobile user and do whatever I want with it. And if I paste this into the Web Token Analyzer, you can actually see that this token is tied to the device. Because it also uses a primary refresh token, so it ties the logon of this user to the device. So this is more powerful than a regular token because it can comply with certain condition access policies. And this token also contains the device ID that was issued on. So basically, if you have a hybrid environment and you do single sign-on to Azure, then that means that whoever has access to your machine can use the single sign-on and access also the Azure part. So then if you have a path from an AD user to an Azure user, and that Azure user has a specific role, there's quite a high chance that you can obtain access to whatever that Azure user also has access to. And that's the Bloodhound plugin. And I think that pretty much concludes what I wanted to show. See, we've already been talking for 1.5 hours, which is quite a long time. So are there any remaining questions about this? I still have to actually publish the blog. Most of the source code is online. The Bloodhound clone is already, the Bloodhound fork is already online. The Road Tools code is not yet online, but I will publish that soon. And Road Tools will also it's also connected to Azure pipelines, so it will automatically build the things from every release that I push to master, so you don't have to install the whole the whole Angular runtime and build the interface yourself. How long does this take me to do? quite long, I think. I didn't keep track, but I started with exploring the internal version, I think, over a year ago. And it really started by just enumerating simple stuff and really thinking about the design I wanted for the database, and then dumping it to the database, and then just clicking through that SQLite browser and finding things. And then finally, I also decided, okay, I want this to be easy accessible, so that needs a GUI, and that also costed a lot of time. Will there be more streams? I don't know. Maybe. Depends. Let me know what you guys find interesting. Maybe I'll do a stream on writing a plugin for RoadTools. I do have some things that I still want to write. That could be possible. My roadmap. Nice. Yeah. I do want to add like an offensive tool to this. So something that would talk to the database, and you could just say, okay, I have this user in this group, and add this user to this group, and then use whichever access token you already have or obtained. Because if you want to add users to groups using the API, that's quite painful, and it involves a lot of unique identifiers and stuff. And I think there's some tooling that makes it much easier, is really nice. Of course, you can already do this using the PowerShell APIs, but those APIs don't always, they don't really support you stealing a token from someone's PowerShell session in memory and abusing that to actually do your stuff. So maybe that. Thanks everyone for attending. I will continue working on finalizing the blog and post that online. And do let me know what you thought of this, if there's any feedback. I'm always interested in learning that. So thank you.